Hello Internet and welcome back. There has been released a new version of the TouchGFX Designer. Now we are at 4.15, I think. And we also have seen a few new releases of the CubeIDE. So new viewers can start here. We are, or I'm going to show you how to get a project up and running on this STM32F746 and how to start the CubeIDE project. There are a few prerequisites for this to work. First of all, you should of course get a copy of the TouchGFX Designer, and the easiest way to do that is actually by getting the CubeMX program, because in there you can download the latest version of the TouchGFX Designer. So if I just start up the CubeMX, let me just show you here on the screen. It starts up, and no, we don't want to right now. So we can when we just want to get the packages, we can just access either the MCU selector or the board selector. That doesn't really matter, but if we just go to the board selector, because that would make sense in this occasion here. Let's see here, it probably needs some updates or something. Let's just find this 746 board here. Take this with the touchscreen. Do we want to initialize all peripherals with the default mode? Yes, please. What's actually really important to say here is the CubeMX is only a hardware configurator. So that means that even though default mode here is set, it doesn't initialize firmware settings like SDRAM timing or load drivers for the external flash or anything like that. So this is just setting up the pins and the pin directions and stuff like that. So we can go to software packs and manage software packs. And if we go to the ST microelectronics here, and then find the ST or the XCube TouchGFX, and expand this, and you can see here the latest version is 4.15.0. So I have it installed already, but we can install it now, and then it will download the program. And what is interesting is that it downloads all the files, but you still need to run the installer. And the installer is located, if you go to, let's see here, you go into a user folder, it looks something like this, and you can go to STM32Cube, then you have this repository. If we go into that, we can go into, I think it's packs and STM here, then you have access to your pack, and which we just downloaded it. And in utilities, PC software, TouchGFX Designer, there you have the installer for TouchGFX Designer. So you install that, and that's one of the things you need. So now we have the CubeMX, we have TouchGFX. You obviously also need the CubeIDE. You need to download that from the ST site. Also, you would need to have the STM32Cube programmer. So the programmer is it's actually a standalone tool, but it's used via the command line interface by TouchGFX to program the physical hardware. So you need to get that as well. And I think you need to go back to the ST site to find that as well. So we have four requirements to make this work. Yeah. Okay. Let me just close this up real quick. And then we can start TouchGFX Designer 4.15. So this currently is the latest version. Now what you see here is the initial screen. You can select what's called an application template, and you can select what is called a UI template. And the application template is where do we want to run this program. So if you just want a simulator, then we just have access to the graphics on a computer screen. But we can change this, and then we have an option to select a lot of different boards here. And I can just search for 746. There is only one application template, but it does come in different versions. If we click on the small I for information here, you can see we have different versions of the application template. We want to use the latest 3.0.2. There are some minor errors or stuff that needs to be done in the old version, so that is fixed in the newer version. That's the easiest thing to say. So we just select that, close this up again, and press select. So now we have selected the application template. Remember that before I just said that CubeMX only configures your hardware. The application template, on the other hand, will configure external flash, SDRAM timings, and all that extra stuff that is needed to make this work. In the UI template, we can actually select a number of different templates. If you want to check out how do radio buttons work, for example, or how do how a clock example, or a dynamic graph, or whatever you want to do here, then there is an example of how to make this work. I'll just go back here and select the blank UI, because I don't want anything in my screen to begin with. So I just press select. So we have the application template, that is our board, and we have a blank UI for template. And we'll just call this a demo app. Where do we want to store this? I'm just using the default location here, and we press create. So now it will create our project, and behind the scenes, it will pull in all the required drivers that I just mentioned. So what we see here is our screen or a canvas. What is nice to know about TouchGFX Designer and TouchGFX in general is that you can work with transparency. So if you load a PNG file that supports transparency, of course, then you can just put stuff on top of each other. So if you want to save memory, TouchGFX is hyper optimized for memory. So if you have something that doesn't fill the whole screen, it will only update that part of the screen. And also if you have transparent parts, you can stack up your visual elements so as in order to save space. And also you'll see in a second, I'll add a button. That button will only be stored once in memory. So if we reuse that button, it won't increase the memory footprint. Okay, so if this is the first time you see TouchGFX, this is our canvas. Over on the left side, we have our screens. So we can have a number of screens, and a new screen will be something you can change into. So and on a screen, you'll have some visual elements. So if we press this plus here, add widget, we have this widget menu, and we can just click on box here. Then we need to close this up again. You can see now we have a box here, and I can resize this box, and this box right now here will work as my background. I can select a color that could be, let's just make it bright red, that's fine. I can go back in here and say I want to have a button, and it's a bit hard to see here. Usually this widget stuff was over in the left pane here, but now it's here. So we have a button. We get some alignment help here, some lines, and we can place this where we want. So this will be my first screen. Very simple. Also, if I add, let's see, we have a text box somewhere. Text area. Just click it here. And this is a text resource here. I don't want to go into much detail about this text, but we can write whatever we want. Like this. Also, we can set colors on this if we want. This is really lovely. And also, we can adjust where we want the text. Actually, I want to set this back to black. This was really horrible. Okay, so, and we can just press add screen up here. Then we got a new screen. And we can add a box and a button on this as well. If I close this up, you can see the button here was added last, so this will actually be on top of the box. If I have the box here, I can drag it and use it as my background. And if we go over here, screen one, I can collapse, and screen two, we can rearrange so the lowest item will be on the, in the background. So if we take the button and drag it underneath the box, it will disappear, but it will in fact just be below the box that is our background. So we just rearrange this real quick, like this. I'll change the color of this one to this fantastic bright green and put the button down here. So now we have two screens, each with one button, and we can just view them over here on the left side. If I go to my screen one here, over on my right side, I can define a name. I can say this is the startup screen, and we have a different some different items here as well. I won't go into details about that now, but this second tab here is interactions, which is really really handy. So I want to change my screen when I press this button here. So I want to add an interaction. The trigger is a button is clicked. It's not a hardware button, it's not a physical button, it's a button on the screen. I only have one here, but I can choose which button that should trigger this interaction. And what do I want to do? I want to change screen. What screen do I want to change into? I want to change to screen 2, and I want a transition that is slide, and I want to slide to the east. That means I will get a sliding transition to the next screen. Everything is saved here. I can press Control S to save, but when I do this, there is no save on this interaction. So I'm going to go to screen 2 and add another interaction, or the first on this screen. When a button is clicked, there's only one button here. Actually, you can see the name of the button is the same, but in a different screen, so they are not the same instance. I want to change screen. I want to change to screen 1, and I want to slide to the west, like this. I can press Run Simulator up here. If I do that, let's see what happens. You can see down here, it is compiling, and the whole bar down here, if I press this, I get a console, so I can see what's going on here. Just press it again, and so the first time, obviously, it takes a little longer to, and I just go here. You see, this is our first screen. If I press this button here, we get a sliding transition to the other screen. It's not super fancy, but it shows the purpose. So if you have installed the STM32 Cube Programmer, we can also press this button called Run Target. And of course, that requires me to plug in this board here. Let me just do like, you heard that. Pops up, and you press Run Target. So what will happen is that we'll see the compile down here, and it should go a little bit faster than the first time. And then it will upload directly to the board. Let's see here. Something is happening. Yes, and it's flashing. I don't know if you can see. Oh, it was flashing through the ST-Link. Now we have the application running here. Maybe you can see here. And we can press the button. And we have a nice green screen. And the camera doesn't really show, but it is this exact example. And we even have the sliding animation with this as well. So now we have a working project in TouchGFX. It's not a fancy project. It's not dynamic in any way, but it shows you how to set up this project. Now we want to add, or we want to access the CubeIDE project because we want to add some hardware interactions or whatever. So I told you you could click down in the bar below here to get the console, but in the rightmost corner here, there's a browse code button. If you press that one, you'll get a folder containing the TouchGFX project. But this is a TouchGFX project. Look at the path here. So if you just go up one folder, that is the whole project. So that is actually our IOC file. That is the CubeMX file configuration, the pin configuration. And we also have a folder called STM32 CubeIDE. And if I open that, I have this project file. And I should be able to just double click this. Let's see what happens. Maybe it will go wrong because I have another project with the same name. Let's see. Currently, I'm using version 1.0.150 of the CubeIDE, so make sure to upgrade to the latest version. Okay. No thanks. Not right now. Okay. So we have now, I think it's this one, STM32F746G_disco. That is our project, but now we are in the CubeIDE. So we should be able to just press debug and then just select it. Actually, let me just remove this project because that will just... I want to remove the project with the same name, then we should not have those naming issues. That is one issue that still remains, as far as I know. You can't rename your project in TouchGFX. Let's try to debug this again. Probably debug the other one. Let's see here. So now we are waiting. So you can see we have a blank screen, and then when I press resume here, we have the red screen again, and it's working. And just to show you, I can if I hold the processor or suspend the processor, we don't respond to our, so the debugging session is running. I just press terminate here, then the target keeps on running, and we go back to our code. So now we have a working project set up in CubeIDE, which is really neat. Let me just see here. You have in the project, you have an application and user and core. You have the main.c, so that is our main file. And also you have access to the, let's see here. We have the model and the presenter and the views of the different screens available here as well. So if you want to add code here, you can just use this. What it does miss at this point is all the header files. I haven't seen those. Maybe they are here somewhere. I haven't, or maybe you need to include them yourself. And also, I really like to have a link directly to my TouchGFX application or the designer project from here. But what is important is that you get all the drivers that you need, all the components here. This is the touchscreen driver. You get that included in this project, just set up. So if you want, or if you need, just to create some graphics and to have that working on a development kit and get started really fast, this is the easy way to get started. If you have a custom board or you want to add a lot of hardware, you might want to go through a custom setup, and I will explain that in another video how to do that. It is not straightforward. As I said in the beginning, CubeMX is only for configuring hardware and pinouts and stuff like that. It does not set up the timings that you need. So you need to add drivers and add a fair amount of code, code that you can find in the project or example like this, but you need to copy that to your own project. That is really super important. So yes, this is the latest version. If you like the video, give me a like or a comment, or yeah, thanks for watching.